I will follow thee, my Saviour, wheresoever my lot may be. Where thou goest, I will follow. Yes, my Lord, I'll follow thee. I will follow thee, my Saviour. Thou didst shed thy blood for me. And though all men should forsake thee, by thy grace I'll follow thee.
For those who trust God's changeless
praise the Lord, is the prisoner free.
His blood can make the fullest clean.
His blood of
Happy Sabbath, God's people. Our call to service this day is taken from Psalm 29, and it says, "Ascribe to the Lord, ye heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Come and sing praises to the Lord of all ages. Come and sing praises to Jesus our Lord. Bow down before him and worship, adore him. Come and sing praises to Jesus our Lord." Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, church. Yeah, so mine's the second. It's like the continuation of what Yuvi said. So it's taken from Psalms 105. Okay. It's taken from Psalms 105, and it says, "Give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wonderful acts. Glorify his name, let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength and seek his face always."
Good afternoon, church. I'll be reading Psalms 100 from the New King James Version. Everybody complains. Right. "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all you land. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his presence with praise, with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gate with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting and his truth endures forever." Amen.
Good morning, saints of God. Is it afternoon? I'm sorry. At least you're listening, yes. Good afternoon, saints of God. Yours, Lord, is the greatness and power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours, Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Taken from 1 Chronicles 29 and verse 11. Today, I accept the privilege to welcome each and every one of you today. Today, I just want to acknowledge and welcome any first-time guests with us. Is there any? Okay, so there's no first-time guests with us, but... Oh, well... Sorry, I'm sorry. Can you please stand and just give us your name? That's the way we do it here at Bilston SDA. Can I have your name, please?
My name is Samia.
Samia. Okay, welcome, Samia. And we have a little secret that we share with everybody here. Okay, that when you come here for the first time, you won't be able to stay away, so you will continue to come. So, I noticed that you are a relative. Is it sister? Yes. You look alike. So, welcome into God's house. To our regular members, we couldn't do it without you, and so you are looking beautiful as always down there. So we welcome you and this blessed happy Sabbath day, and we thank you that you have come and that you will continue to enjoy the rest of what we have in store for you. Last but not least, our two uni students, they couldn't stay away. You know? They couldn't stay away, and so we are going to make it special for them. We're going to feed them up, yeah? And send them back with all the love and happiness that we have to give to them, okay? Welcome one, welcome all, and continue to enjoy the rest of the Sabbath, okay?
Worship His Majesty. To Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority flows from His throne unto His own, His anthem reign. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Jesus the King. Majesty, worship His Majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Majesty, worship His Majesty. Unto Jesus be glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority, unto His own, His anthem raise. So exalt, lift up the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship His Majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Please be seated.
Happy Sabbath to everyone. Sabbath. We're in God's house. Amen. Let us adopt a posture of reverence as we now seek to approach the throne of grace. Heavenly Father, creator of all mankind, we so humbly approach your throne of grace to pay homage and servitude to your holy name. We thank you for your blessings, which are beyond measure. We thank you for the past week, that even through our toils and tribulations, Lord, you've been with us. And you've blessed us even when we haven't noticed. We thank you for loving us, although we're not deserving of it. We thank you so much for being the God who you are. We thank you this day for the sacred Sabbath day, when we can separate ourselves from our secular activities to commune with you, to feast on your words, to sing praise to your holy name, and to commemorate the act of creation by which you made the world we know. Lord, the world is now ravaged with sin. Its evidence is everywhere, throughout nature, throughout mankind. People are in turmoil, confusion. They know not where to come or to go. But we, your servants, have your word, and in you we are certain of your soon coming. Lord, we thank you for those words because it gives us comfort, it gives us cheer. We pray for those who are in dire need of your intervention, the sick, the lame, those with difficulties, whether it be financial, whether it be mental, physical. Lord, touch them, heal them. Send your Holy Spirit to remind them to look towards you, the author and finisher of the faith, that in you they can find the healing balm that no human hand can touch. Forgive us of our sins, Lord, the things that we do knowingly or unknowingly. Bind us closer to you. And today, Lord, as we celebrate Sabbath, raise our voices to you, we request the presence of the Holy Spirit to descend upon us. Be with us. As the angels listen to us sing, Lord, I know they will enjoy it as much as we do. Bless us now, Lord, and be with us, we pray, in your holy name. Amen. Amen.
At this time, we're going to sing some of the favorites. And we're going to sing the speaking. I probably was hearing me singing while in my mind I was speaking. I'm sorry, I'm going to sing some of the favorites, and we have three of them that are the top, and so we're going to do them from 1 to 3. And one of the favorites that we will sing is Great Is Thy Faithfulness, and I'll give you a little thing on the background of that. But number one is 341. That's the top favorite. Somebody's smiling.
Great is thy faithfulness is the top one.
No,
to go with the Lord first.
You give me them back to front. That's why you told me number one, number two, and number three. Okay, so he said, Great is thy faithfulness is the most favorite. So we're going to sing 341. And we are not going to sing it the traditional way, you know, we're going to sing it.
And open the life Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, to Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Oh, perfect redemption,
praise the Lord,
praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Amen. I don't know, since you're facing me, you will not be able to see some of you what is happening behind me. And I noticed that the first one almost flew away. But it seemed that he had a hand out that was ready to fly. And some people were smiling. This or that song made them really happy. We thank God. Amen?
Amen.
Yes, our next hymn is 476. Burdens are lifted at Calvary.
And dread a burden.
Savior can see every heartache and tear.
I just want to give you something on that one, just before we sing. He said that the saddest book in the Bible is, which one? The saddest book, not the verse. Anybody have an idea?
Lamentation.
Its very name means weeping or wailing in grief. Lamentations is Jeremiah's mournful cry of anguish over the suffering of Judah and Jerusalem. Destroyed and desolate, Jerusalem is personified as a lonely widow. How deserted lies the city, once so full of people. How like a widow is she, who once was great among the nations. A crown of sorrows is remembering happier days. All the splendor has departed from the daughter of Zion. In the days of affliction and wandering, Jerusalem members all treasures that pearls in the days of old. And this is just part of what is behind the hymn. And so we sing, great is thy faithfulness, and I'm told that it's the most popular requested hymn.
And during this singing of this hymn, we'll be collecting the offering.
Oh God, my Father, there
to us. We are thankful that we can say, in you we live, move, and have our being. We want to thank you for putting it within our hearts to give. And so we have returned a portion of what you have given unto us. We pray that your divine blessings will rest upon you. We ask that you will continue to provide. May we not only give of our means, but may we give of ourselves entirely to you to be used in your service, we pray, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me? Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to read some scripture-inspired hymns, and Alice will let us know where they're from in the Bible. The title of the songs. Let the word of Christ dwell. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another, in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. That's Colossians 3:16. Here we go, Alice.
A shelter in the time of storm, hymn 5:28.
There are many songs. This is where you read this bit. There are many songs that are inspired by the Bible verses, some great hymns of faith that have stood the test of time, as well as some contemporary songs that will continue to be sung for many years to come. Here are but a few, some of which are immediately recognizable. How many can you recognize? One. Each one will be like a shelter from the wind and a refuge from the storm, like streams of water in desert and shadow of great rock in a thirsty land. Isaiah 32. For now we see only a reflection as an in mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known.
Face to face with Christ, my Savior.
And that's 1 Corinthians 13:12. Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. The Lord wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out the heavens like a tent.
How great is our God. Chris Timlin.
And that's taken from Psalms 104:1-2. 4. Clap your hands, all you nations. Shout to God with cries of joy. For you make me glad by your deeds, Lord, and I sing for joy at what your hands have done.
Shout to the Lord.
That's taken from Psalms 47 and Psalms 92:4. That is why I am suffering as I am, yet this is no cause for shame, because I know whom I have believed and am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until that day.
I know whom I have believed, hymn 5:1-1.
2 Timothy 1:12. Psalms 89. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. With my mouth I will make known thy fullness to all great nations.
I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing.
Joshua 6:20. So the people shouted when the priest blew with the trumpets, and it came to pass when the people heard the sounds of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell. The wall fell down flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and the rock, and they took the city.
Song: Joshua fit the battle of Jericho.
Are we knowing these things? These songs. I know you do, James. 1 John 5:4. For whosoever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith.
Faith is the victory, 6:08.
Revelation 12:13. His eyes were as a flame. His eyes were like a flame of fire on his hand. Were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God.
Crown him with many crowns.
2 Timothy 1, verse 12. For which the cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I believe, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day.
I know who I have believed, 5:1:1.
Psalms 150, verse 2. Praise him for all his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness.
Praise him, praise him.
Lamentations 3:20, 23. This I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassion fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness.
Psalms 139, 23, 24. Search me, O God, and know my heart true. And know my heart, try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, lead me in the way everlasting.
Cleanse me, search me, O God.
Isaiah 6:3. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory.
Early in the morning, our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in thee, persons, blessed Trinity.
Revelations 4:8. And the four beasts, and each of them six wings about him, and they were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. Early in the morning, our song shall rise to thee, holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Psalms 137. By the rivers of Babylon, we sat and wept when we remembered Zion. There on the poplars, we hung our harps, for there our captors asked us for songs. Our testaments, demand songs of joy. They said, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How can we sing the songs of the Lord while he is in a foreign land?
By the rivers of Babylon.
Psalms 42. As a deer pants for the streams of water, so my soul pants for my God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When I can, I go and meet with God. My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me all day long, where is your God? These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I used to go to the house of God under the protection of the mighty one, with shouts of joy and praise among the festive throng.
As the deer panted for the waters, so my soul longed after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee.
Galatians 1, 4-5. Who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us out of the present evil age, according to the will of God, of our God and Father, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen.
To God be the glory, great things he had done. So love he the world that he gave us his son.
18. Matthew 7:24. Jesus says, therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock.
We'll build on the rock, the living rock, on Jesus, the rock of ages.
2 Kings 6:17. And Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw and beheld the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha.
Is that I may see.
Psalms 23:1. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down, to lie in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake.
Psalms 23, it's probably the most famous psalm that has become a popular hymn. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me down to lie in green pastures. He leadeth me in paths of waters. By the same text is related to the hymn, the King of Love, my shepherd is, whose goodness falleth never. I nothing lack, I am his, and in his mine forever. Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you. If you are suffering from type 2...
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm back again. I'll stand to the side. Okay. I'm going to read you two poems from one of my books, Chicken Soup for the Soul by Jack Cornfield and his mates. It says, I'm going to read you two poems from one of my books, Chicken Soup for the Soul by Jack Cornfield and Victor Henson. Stories that restore your faith in human nature. The first one I'm going to read is about a soldier that was disabled at war. And the title is Faith. We are a rugged breed or squad. If we weren't, we wouldn't be around today. Yes, we are a rugged breed. In many ways, we've been blessed with a savvy of spirit that isn't given to everyone. Let me say that this refusal of total or full acceptance of one's disability all hooked up with one thing, faith, an almost divine faith. Now, down in the reception room of the Institute of Physical, Medical, and Rehabilitation, over in East 400, over at 400 East 34th Street in New York City, there's a bronze plaque that is riveted on the wall. During the months of coming back to the Institute for treatment, two or three times a week, I rolled through reception room many times, coming and going. But I never quite made it, took the time to pull over to read what the plaque said. It said, by an unknown Confederate soldier. Then one afternoon, I read it. And then I read it again. And when I finished for the second time, I was near bursting. Not in despair, but in an inner glow, with an inner glow that had me straining to grip the arm of my wheelchair. I'd like to share it with you. It is called A Creed for Those Who Suffer. It says, I ask God for strength that I might achieve. I was made weak that I might learn humbly to obey. I ask God for health, that I might do great things. I was given infirmity that I might do better things. I ask God for riches that I might be happy. I was given poverty that I might be wise. I ask God for power that I might have the praise of men. But I was given weakness that I might feel the need of God. I ask for all things that I might enjoy life. I was given life that I might enjoy all things. I got nothing I asked for, but everything I'd hoped for. Almost despite myself, my unspoken prayer were answered. I am among most richly blessed. The second one I'd like to share with you this afternoon is showing us how when we come to Christ, we become more valuable, we're worth more. And it is demonstrated by the sale of a violin. It's called The Touch of the Master's Hand. It was battered and scarred, and the auctioneer thought it was scarcely worth his while to waste much time on this old violin. He held it up with a smile. What am I bidding for, folks? $1? Who will give me $2? $2? Who will give me $3? $3? $3? Gone. But no, from the room far back, a gray-haired man came forward and picked up the bow, then wiped the dust off the old violin and tightened the loosened string. He played a melody pure and sweet as a caroling angel sing. The music ceased, and the auctioneer, with a voice quite low, said, "What am I bidding for this old violin?" He held it up with the bow. $1,000. Who will make it $2? Who will make it $3? 3,000 once, 3,000 twice, and going gone, he said. The people cheered, but some cried. We do not quite understand what change is worth. Swift came the reply. The touch of the master's hand. And many a man with life out of tune and battered and scarred with sin is auctioned cheaply to the thoughtless crowd, much like the old violin. A mess of pottage, a glass of wine, a game, and he travels on. He's going once, he's going twice. He's going. He's almost gone. But the master came, and the foolish crowd never quite understood the worth of a soul and the change that's wrought by the touch of the master's hand. Thank you.
One of the favorites that we that was given and came from the children, and it's entitled "Jesus Loves Me, This I Know." And behind that hymn is a story, and it's entitled "From the Story of a Dying Child." Karl Barth, the renowned Swiss theologian, one day was asked what he considered to be his greatest theological discovery. He replied, "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." One Sunday at the close of a worship service at the Swiss Colony Library, Francis Schaeffer asked the congregation to sing "Jesus Loves Me." He smiled and added, "This is my favorite hymn." Barth and Schaeffer would remind us that the most profound truths are usually the most simple. Indeed, there is no more sublime truth than that expressed by the words of this simple, beloved hymn. This song had a unique birth. Two sisters, Anna and Susan Warner, live near West Point, New York. They taught a Sunday school Bible class in their home for West Point cadets. Between them, they wrote more than 70 books. In 1860, they collaborated in writing the novel Say and Seal, which became a best-selling book of that day. In it, Johnny Fox, a young boy, suffered from a lingering disease. Near the end of the novel, Johnny asked his Sunday school teacher to hold him and sing to him as he often had done. His teacher, holding the boy, started to make up and sing some simple words. Jesus loves me, this I know. The plot of that novel and this touching scene gave birth to the now famous hymn. The four stanzas appeared in the novel as a song of comfort for the dying boy. This hymn has been sung by more children than has any other. It is considered to be the best known hymn in the world, being translated by missionaries as a mean of presenting the gospel in a clear, simple way. In 1861, William Bradbury composed the tune to which we now sing these words. Jesus loves me, this I know. Hymn number 190.
Jesus loves me, this I know.
Yes. Good afternoon.
We're going to sing a song that means a lot to us. But I'm not going to say anything more until we've done the song. This is a song that holds some special meaning for Marlene and myself. It's a song that speaks of the relationship between us and Christ. How his words touch, fill our hearts. For us, we both agree that this is a communion song that expresses the relationship that we should have with our God. Now, as to the song itself, I'm a great lover of the old songs. Yes, I love the old songs. My favorite song is Abide With Me, and Marlene and Marla can tell you I'm banging away at the piano with it as very often. But am a big lover of the contemporary songs, the new songs. I remember we went to Newbold. Which church did I go to again? I went to the contemporary one. That's my favorite. Keith and Kristen Getty are the writers of the song that we just sang. And this particular song reminds me, I warned Amu, of the very first song she did that I assisted her with at Cannet Road, which was, what was the song again? No, I wrote it down somewhere. It was Christ in Song. You remember the song, Amu? You were a little bit then, in those days. In Christ Alone. You remember it now? Little Amu there singing up front. You remember? Yes. And there are other songs. Most of the songs that Kristen and Keith and Townsend wrote have become great hymns in many churches. And I do like his song. But the lyrics are very touching. But most of all is Laura's story. Now, we're not prepared to sing Blessings to you. But Blessings is a very powerful song. Blessing was written at the time when Laura's story and her husband were going through a very bad time. The husband had a brain tumor. Nobody could help them with it. And they both turned to Christ in prayer until he recovered. During the COVID years, as a family, we went through quite a lot, which many people here can relate to. And that song, Blessings, really, really appealed to my heart. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing come through tears? And what if the thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know that he is there? So I leave these words with you. Thank you, brethren.
So today I will be talking about music and the influence it has on you and your relationship with God. Music has the ability to deepen the meaning of words that accompany it. The right kind of spirit-led music can be an immensely powerful tool that aids us in bringing our body and soul into submission and control by the Holy Spirit. Music can be both our prayer to God as well as a way to show our affection to Him. Music often prepares the hearts of the congregation to receive the spoken words of the sermon. Music at its core influences our spiritual lives and our relationship with God, either drawing us closer to the Lord or quenching the Holy Spirit. Most have seen in their own lives that music can profoundly affect emotions, either positively or negatively. Music of the world will diminish your ability to walk in the Spirit, but spiritual music will contribute to your walk with God and your spirit-filled life. Music has a way of filling in gaps, thought, feeling, and emotion that words cannot do justice. God is not swayed by impressive acoustics. He wants hearts that first make it to a point to love Him and live right before Him.
again. Do you want to finished. Go?
I said, no, my phone is on silence. And there is a request for a song. Now, time is, I did warn you, by the way, that we're going to be here for a little while, didn't I? But that's okay. I think we'll fill it in. We don't see him very often. Chinu has asked for a particular song. It's 590. And we'll sing a couple of verses of that song. Is that okay, Chinu? Trust and obey, is it? You know that one, Tyrese? When we walk with the Lord. First and last verses.
Verse, last verse. Amen. Thank you, Chinu. You feeling better? Nice, nice, nice. Okay. Right. We're going to bear with me a few minutes while we just bring things together. So far, what we've been talking about today, is there any doubt that there is power in music? Yes, there is doubt?
No doubt.
Ah, there is no doubt that there is power in music, right? Power to do what? To obey. I'm sure there are some songs that they say to disobey. But it is for now, aren't we? All right, Brother Michael, I am trying to do some stuff here and it's not obeying me. This is moving. So yes, there is power and indeed glory in music, isn't there? And as far as we're concerned, where we are today, this morning, enjoying the fellowship, we have been glorifying God, have we not? Yes. We've heard experiences, we've heard songs, we've heard poems,
And bringing it all together, there's one thing among all that we have said that suggests that music is, and it's been said already, very emotionally connected to our hearts. Is that right? Music, or people express themselves through music than maybe any other way. Yes, people can talk and talk and talk, but for some reason in music, there are ways of bringing out that feeling. There are ways of expressing oneself in a way that no other way can do. That's why there is no question that music is powerful. But what we're going to be focusing, and what we've been focusing on today, is how we can use music to strengthen our relationship, not just with God, but with everybody else. What do you say? Amen. One of the questions asked in Sabbath school was, what is the purpose of congregational singing? And what did you say? Do you remember what you said? Hey, you've forgotten already? Yeah, wasn't there something about praising God, coming together, you know, expressing ourselves, right? So, you know, what makes music music, though? You know, what's the definition of music? Let's go back to basics here. What is, oh, you've got the answer up there, haven't you? What, how do you move from speaking to music? Is it words that make music, or is it the instrument that make music? Or is it both? Yes? So what makes the music, as you can see there, a combination of things to do with rhythm, melody, and harmony? Have you ever heard a song that doesn't have rhythm, that is not harmonic, that doesn't have a melody? Now let me ask you one question. Who came first, the birds singing or humans singing? Do you think that humans might have had some ideas from the birds or the animals? So we know that birds whistle. What other animal do we get our singing from, could you say? Or melody of movement or rhythm? Would you say a horse sings? No. When a horse brays, do you think that there's something that makes you want to echo what the author? But when a horse trots, is there rhythm in that? What noise does a horse make? Clippity-clop, clippity-clop. Right? They even have, I think I've seen in Olympics or somewhere, they've got these horse trials where they have horses dancing to a rhythm, and they score points, and of course they get medals based on what the horses can do. So not just humans, but animals, we've got ways of making music. Now, I want to ask, who was the inventor of music? God. That's the easy one, isn't it? The first mention of music. Now, some people will say that, who was it? The Beatles or something? No, it can't be the Beatles. Somebody else in America, or somebody else, some other part of the world. But music started where? Where? I didn't hear. In the garden. Oh, in heaven. Okay, right. Of course, as far as the Bible is concerned, we know that in Genesis, it talks about a certain man called who? Jubal. Jubal's was the father of the harp and the organ. Have you heard of, I heard it in one of the songs this morning, Jubilee. You know, you come from Jubal. Have you heard of a Jubilee event that's somber? Have you heard of a Jubilee event that's not about praising and enjoying or celebrating? Yeah? So again, it apparently comes from jubal, the instruments, and singing, and what singing can do to express not ourselves only, but express God's goodness, God's love, and in fact, our moods. Yes? Of course, in Genesis 31, we also learn about, we also learn in when the crossing of the Red Sea, what happened there? Moses were singing a song, yeah? Praising the Lord for his goodness and his mercy. Now, you've probably heard of genres of music, yeah? It's like types of music. There are genres of lots of other things, films and so on, but music, they tend to talk about genre. How many, have you heard of the different types of music? Yes, yes? Like? Those up there. Some of them up there, you've probably not heard them, right? But of course, there are many, 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 many different types of music that you're familiar with there. But that's not all types of music they think there are. Loads, yeah. Number? 25 or 100 or something? Yeah? These are but a few. Other types of music that I've not heard of. In fact, I can't even tell you what some of them are because they're a little interesting to talk about. But Spotify, you're familiar with Spotify?
Yes.
Yes? They have a library of about 82 million songs. And they have, they can tell, I'm registered, I'm a member, subscribe to them. And at the end of the year, they tell me the kind of songs I've sung and the rages and the genres and so on. But according to Spotify, there are, I find it astonishing, 5,000 different genres of music. 5,000. More than there are languages. How can that be? Anyway, that's what it says. Of course, what our preference is for music will depend on a lot of things. Our cultural background, our upbringing, the contents of the geographical location, or association with other people, or religion, and also law. You know that there are some countries where they ban music, or they're very prescriptive in the type of music that you can play. Other than Christianity, do you know, Judaism perhaps? Do you know of other religion? I think maybe in lots of other religions, of course, they play music, but it is very different, isn't it?
Yes.
When you go into a mosque, do they play music? There is an order of doing it, and I think sometimes they have chants.
Yeah.
It is certainly forbidden to sing and pray in the Muslim world. You know, they consider prayer as a very somber occasion. But where singing is concerned, it's very, 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 very restricted. But as far as we are concerned, are there restrictions in what we do? Are there? Hmm? Well, of course, there are restrictions in how we sing. I remember when I was younger, I was practicing a song on the guitar for two sisters for Sabbath school. And the Sabbath school superintendent at the time said, where are you going? I said, I'm going to play this song. He said, with that? It was my guitar. I'd practiced a lot on this guitar. And the sisters were expecting us to sing. He said, no, you can't play that. It would desecrate the Sabbath, he said, of the guitar. What's the difference between the guitar and the lyre? Or the harp? They're related strings instruments, aren't they? I also remember, and I think Brother McIntosh alluded to it this morning, that there are times in church where, you know, you can only play certain instruments at certain times of the day in church. And the organ was definitely forbidden, even though I play the organ. There are people who didn't know anything about even switching the organ, telling me what it is and how it should be played and so on. But, you know, we had to go along with it. I once went to a concert one evening after an afternoon program. They were having a service, like not even a social, I think it was a service. And another colleague and I were going to play a duet on the piano. And when we got to the place, the elder of the church said, we said we wanted two pianos because we were going to play a duet. He said, you have to play on the same piano. I said, no, we've practiced and we need it. And there were two pianos. There was one here and one someplace else. He said that, no, that piano is only for the mornings. Now, they weren't even in a church. They were in a hall that they rented on a Sabbath. Yes? And in that place, they do all sorts of other things on other days. But he didn't want us to play the two pianos. And despite our pleas, he said, whether you want two pianos or three pianos, one piano you're going to have. You know, and that's all there is to it. So, of course, I got vexed and I went home. They were calling us back, but by that time, I'd lost it all. Yeah? So, you know, it wasn't particularly encouraging. You know, growing up and having to deal with the experiences. Now, one of the problems here we've got, folks, is that when it comes to our choice of music, do we impose our own likes on other people? Do we? Hey, what was Donald saying this morning in home, mother and father? I know Sister Mac and Brother Mac are here. But, you know, maybe young people today, I don't know whether your parents are as interfering, but there are only certain types of music that are allowed in certain places. In fact, we know of a brother who doesn't go to church at all, but he wouldn't allow anything in the home, but was it Jim Reeves? And he wasn't even a church member. So, you know, we have our problems, and, you know, that can be disinhibiting. That can sometimes, when we're trying to restrict it, so our ability to glorify the Lord, yeah? Because music is not dangerous. There is danger, of course, with music, if that's not a contradiction. What we do with it is a problem, isn't it? Because do we want music to suppress us? Do we want music to deny us? Do we want music to stop us from doing the right thing? Surely not. Aristotle, one of those philosophers, he said famously, music can be a very, 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 very bad thing. But he also said that music can very good and make a bad person bad, but it can make a good person good. Does that mean we should dismiss music? Why not then use the good in music to be better? Do you think that God, who invented music, as we said, intended for music not to be used positively? In those days gone by, we've read about the Bible where they've done all sorts of things. They prayed, they sang, David more so than all. There are two books in the Bible that are particularly dedicated to singing. And besides those, there are other books as well where it is said that singing was a very important part, not just of worship, but of recognizing, of glorifying, doing all the things that help to express our feelings. Now, music is also, of course, good for health. Is that right? Those of you in the medical world, not perhaps somewhere, they say that some people are afraid of dentists, you know, if they play the right type of music, it helps them. And it probably is true. If you go to an operating theater, there are some places where they will actually have music in the background to send you to sleep. You know, by the time you listen to the first two words, you've forgotten all the rest of it, yeah? You know, so, you know, music can actually do a lot of things to soothe the mind. There was a story about this this king who he had mental problems. You remember? I'm not talking about Saul. But in recent times, you know, a few hundred years ago, and this guy, he just closeted himself and didn't want to do anything. But they had on tour a most famous singer who came, and the family said deliberately, go next door and sing as loud as you can. So this guy started to sing, and the king, having been, you know, in his demented state and isolated himself, having heard the song, the music, he came out and asked, "What is this I'm hearing?" And having heard that, he completely changed. In fact, that king, as soon as he heard that, he made sure that this guy was able to sing every day. And as a result of doing it for several months, he went on to reign for an extra 10 years, his normal life, not locked in himself. So there is power in the music. When Joshua was fighting the Battle of Jericho, what happened? How did they win the war? Music. When Gideon was chosen with 300 people, what were their weapons? Music, the trumpet. Yes? And they made the difference by winning their wars, didn't they? Yeah? So, you know, there is power in music. Now, countries recognize this. Kings and rulers recognize this. And you have countries, the national anthem, their national anthems, where they talk and acknowledge. Let me give you an example. Now, we know "God Save Our Gracious Queen" as the words of the national anthem. But those are not really the original words. One of the things that it says, "O Lord God, arise." Yeah? Scatter our enemies. It says, "Make them fall." Does that remind you of what David was saying? Yes? I have others here. The Jamaican national anthem talks about "Eternal Father, bless our land, guide us with your mighty hand." I haven't forgotten some of the others. This one, the Indian, I've got this on good authority, by the way. If I'm wrong, it's only because I've got it elsewhere. Yeah, it does talk about the Father helping them, you know, to look after their people. And the Anguilla national anthem talks about "God bless Anguilla." Yeah. and so on. You know, so, you know, they recognize where God, what power there is, and they express it in music. When you go to a football match, you hear these guys, some of them can't sing, but they sing loud, don't they? And they sing with voices, they sing with emotion, they sing with power. And actually, it drowns out those who can't sing at all. But, you know, the difference is that it is a very powerful expression. When people are marching, when you win a medal, when you're having a state a celebration and stuff, you know, they sing their national anthem with, you know, on top of their voices. What is that saying? And bearing in mind that the national anthems have God very much in them, although for many, they have other words, of course. It's saying that there is power. You know, because if there is power and you believe in that power, it can make things happen, can't it? Now, I'm mindful of the time, so I'm going to try and cut. I'm going to cut a whole lot of things. Many years ago, then, we heard about music that was blessed by God and given by God. How did we get to a situation where churches stopped using music, instruments? What happened? We've got to the, some people believe that, you know, to be somber, to be reverend, have no music at all. Have silence. And if you're going to sing, sing to yourself. Now, thousands and thousands of years ago, do you remember the Christians when they were being persecuted? It wouldn't have been a good idea to be going around with a trumpet, would it? You know, and sing, because they had to worship in silence. They had to be, brother and sister, Adina and Luca. Yeah, they were saying that, up until the 80s, their fathers particularly, they were talking about their experiences. They had to hide to worship. They had to be underground. They couldn't be heard. You certainly wouldn't want the organ. You wouldn't want the trumpet, you wouldn't want any instrument sounding, because that would be a bad thing for one's health. But, you know, over the years, the centuries, people have adopted this approach that, you know, music should be somber and, you know, almost not be heard. And so we've got the situation today where some people say that one instrument is acceptable in church, the other not. And we have all sorts of worries. Now, I don't know why. You remember William Booth? Salvation Army. Yeah? They went around spreading the word. He fervently believed that spreading the word to the poor, it was in Nottingham mostly that he started, but it went elsewhere, and in fact ended up in some 58 countries of the world, spreading the word through song. So they had, not an organ, you can go around with an organ or a piano, they would have bands, and they're made of trombones and trumpets and any, you know, portable things. And it worked, because they brought thousands, this was about 100 and how many years ago, you know, it brought hundreds and thousands of people into the church. So what are we doing with music? Are we restricting music in our worship? Because we're worried that, you know, the devil is the director of music. If we do nothing, I think the devil may well be the director of it, but we need to capitalize on it, don't we? And sing with our hearts, sing with our voices, and sing to express our love to God and to other people. I want us to, I am going to close by just reminding us, even Paul was telling the people that, you know, music is a useful way of making sure that they focused on God. You know, the Jews followed music. Music helped them to study the Bible. Music helped them to memorize the Bible. Many of the things we remember, we can associate them with songs as well, right? Now, it's all right, this is, I'm skipping and finishing now. We must remember, though, that, you know, one of the greatest power in music is to praise God. And one of the greatest instruments of music is us as individuals. Now, anybody here who doesn't play a musical instrument, don't tell me that I only play the radio. Right? Anybody who doesn't play a musical instrument. And I will challenge you and say you're wrong. You got a voice. You got hands, right? If you're happy and in your clap your head. Although some of us, we're afraid or ashamed or not even sure whether to clap or what. What about our feet? What about when we can't sing? You know, there was a guy when we were living in Bristol, he would sing. No, he would whistle. Why are you whistling? He said, I can't sing. But he whistles. You know, these are our human instruments. And, you know, that's how it started. So if that's how it started, what's stopping us? I think prejudice. And I think values and other things are, you know, getting in the way. So there is power in music and song to lead, to lift, to express our love. And if we fail to use it, I think we are missing out. Don't underestimate the power of music. It helps us to fight temptation. Paul wrote to the Ephesians and told them not to be foolish, but to be wise. He said that they were not to let the world get to them and drive them to choose negative things like wine and so on. He said that they were to be filled with the Holy Spirit instead and speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. They were to sing and make music in their hearts to the Lord. Paul was saying the people were reminding them of the power of music. You can gain the victory if... Well, we can all gain the victory if we recognize God in the gift of music and don't allow things to get in our way. When is anybody merry? Let them sing psalms. That is, if one is overflowing with joy, true joy, joy to the Lord, it should be expressed in psalms or praise, just like the song of Moses. Through music, those inspired to write songs remind us that when time is no more, when the roll is called up yonder, the trumpet of the Lord shall sound. When we all get to heaven in the mansions bright and blessed, we will want to sing the wondrous story, sing the wondrous love of Jesus. When he comes again, we shall behold him. We'll be face to face with Christ, our Savior, and we'll praise him. And with the angel, we will sing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." We'll sing of his mercy and his grace forever and ever. So, let us therefore not be hindered or weakened by the negative aspects of music, but through its power, let us magnify and glorify the Lord more in our spiritual journeys and throughout our lives. Amen. Amen.
Stop.
thankful that we were able to sing today. And some may say that we did not have a sermon. Does anybody feel that way? You want to do a sermon? Something that you just sit down and did not engage in? Are you happy about today? Yeah, I see head shaking and I hear voices. Are you happy about today? Should we do it again? When?
It seems like all the loud people are up here.
Yeah, as we go through the Bible, we'll find that the Bible speaks a lot about singing. It's a pity that we don't sing more. And so we are happy that we are able to, all of us, were able to sing today. We thank God for voices. Don't you thank God for your voice? Amen. Some people will say that they can't sing. That is not true. Everybody can sing. Your key may be in your pocket, but at least you can sing. And we want to thank God. We are thankful and happy for those who contributed their favorites. We want to thank God for those who are brave enough to come up here and do their part. And we have learned something from those who presented, and we thank God for that. And all, let us say praise God for a day well spent. Amen?
Amen.
And so we, as we continue to worship, let us not only praise God while we are in church, but let us endeavor to praise God throughout the remaining days of our lives. And so we look forward for the great day when Jesus will come. And all of us, even though you think that you cannot sing, on that day, you will be able to sing. And you will sing the song of Moses and the Lamb. And one songwriter says that angels will fold their wings as we sing. Because the songs that we will sing, they will not be able to sing them. So until then, let us continue to sing and march along. We'll be singing 647. Okay, we'll sing the first and last verse.
Should we all stand? My eyes
have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grass of blood is sown. He has loosed the building, bumping up the terrible sin soul. His truth is marching on. Glory. The sea, he was dwelling in his bosom that fathers you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us live to make men free. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory,
I've been noticing that the head elder have been enjoying this very much. If I haven't seen anybody else, I've seen him. So now we're going to call you to give the benediction first. Come up here and enjoy yourself giving the benediction.
Can we just bow our heads in prayer, please? Loving kind Father in heaven, thank you so much for the time that we have spent together. Thank you for helping us to exercise our voices, to sing praises to you. And we thank you too for everyone who have participated. We ask, Lord, that as we continue to sing, go home during the week and the months ahead, that we will continue to remember you, and that singing is a part of praising and worship. And so, Lord, give us that ability to continue to do so. And so, Lord, we ask that as we leave, that your Spirit will guide us and take us safely home, and that you will bring us back together where we can continue to sing and worship you. So we thank you for everything you have done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We've got a not so new meditation. The words benediction are, may God be with you, but it will be sung to the tune of Abide With Me.
Light refreshments, very light, but hot.